The call stack is a concept used in most programming languages today. Therefore, regardless of the field you're in as a developer, it's necessary to understand the call stack. Because it's associated with various topics, such as the event loop, closure, and error handling, which we'll cover in upcoming videos, I've decided to make a separate video to explain the call stack in advance. The call stack is where information related to the functions we use gets stored every time we use them. Call in call stack refers to the call of a function. So what is this stack? If you've studied coding, you might have learned about queues and stacks. Queue is first in, first out, where the first one to come in is the first to go out. And stack is last in, first out, where the last one to come in is the first to go out. In computer programs where functions are called in a chain, they come in and out of the memory in this stack form. Let's take a look at what this means with an example. If you want to practice together, click on the pinned comment and come into this Notion page. I've prepared the example in JavaScript so you can easily follow along without installing anything special. The overall principle is the same in most programming languages. First, let's look into the code for example 0. Right now, let's focus without this console log part. As seen, there are three functions present, and the code has one function calling another. The function f1 calls f2, and function f2 calls f3. Now, let's understand what happens in memory when this code is executed. In order for a computer program to execute a function, it needs to load it into memory. Just like how we need to recall the recipe to make a sandwich in our heads. I said, that function call related information gets stacked to stack. When the F1 function is first called, it's loaded into the call stack, it comes in first and leaves last, positioning itself at the bottom of the stack. When the function F1 calls F2, F2 is loaded on top of it. Similarly, when F3 is called, it is loaded on top of F2. Therefore, when multiple functions sequentially call other functions, the function that calls another function is executed before the function being called. That's why it gets stacked first. On the other hand, what would be the order of termination? At the point when the last called function, F3, terminates, F2 is still not finished executing. That's why you can see F3 coming out of the stack before F2 does. Similarly, F2 comes out of the stack first because at the time F2 finishes executing, F1 is still not finished executing.
Now, I see why we use a stack.
This time, we will take a closer look by debugging this ourselves. If you click on the links right below the titles of each example, you can see a web page where the corresponding code is run as a JavaScript file. For the convenience of the practice, these web pages have been modified so that the results of the log are displayed on the screen by changing the console.log function. At the top of the Notion page, I've specified how to open developer tools for debugging, shortcut keys, and more. Then, let's do some debugging now. Open developer tools and select the source tab, then open the script.js file. You just need to click on these in order, then you'll be able to see this JavaScript code. Now, I'm going to put breakpoints like this at each place marked with red circles in the comments. And then, when you refresh the page, the execution of the code stops at the first breakpoint that's run like this. From now on, we'll be paying attention to this space called the call stack as we run the code to the next breakpoint. Currently, there's only one anonymous item in this call stack. This points to the global context where the F1 function is called. It's not a space named after a specific function. Now, when we move to the point where the F1 function is executed, you can see that the F1 function is placed on top of it like this. The next thing is that the F2 function gets executed and rises above the F1 function. And lastly, you can see that the F3 function is placed on top. Through the log reflected on the web page, you can intuitively understand in what order the code was executed. Now, if you proceed to the next breakpoint, the F3 function falls off. You can see the F2 function, the F1 function, and finally, the anonymous function being removed from the stack in order. Each of these items on the call stack is known as a stack frame. These stack frames contain the scope of each function, that is, the range of data accessible within a given function. Let's look at the code of example 1. As you see here, there's a global variable that does not belong to any specific function. It's in the outermost scope. Each function has these variables given as parameters, and there is one variable declared within each of these functions. Now we will go through the same process as before to do some debugging. Please open the developer tools and the source tab, then set a breakpoint and refresh. We're at the point where the function F3 has been executed and 4 stacks have been piled up. After you open the scope space, you can see that when you click on each stack frame, the variables accessible in that scope are displayed like this. This variable A in the global scope can be accessed from any frame. You can see that the parameters given to each function and the local variables are included in the scope of that frame. Like this, we could examine the relationship between frames on the call stack and scopes. Now, let's move on to the next concept. Example 2 is a code that intentionally causes a problem. You can see that function F1 and F2 are calling each other.
Isn't such a constantly communicating relationship something to be seen positively?
In programming, such codes cause errors. If you open the console tab, you can see that there is a range error, and it indicates that the maximum call stack size has been exceeded. Through these records below, you can see how the F1 function and the F2 function kept calling each other and ended up in this situation. Let's move back to the source tab and try debugging by setting some breakpoints. As you can see, the F1 and F2 functions are continuously stacking in the call stack alternately like this. When this exceeds the allowed range, an error occurs. Just like this, when functions are called continuously over the threshold, it leads to a stack overflow error. Let's take a look at the recursive function code in example 3. This recursive function subtracts 1 from the initial parameter and calls itself each time. There is a looping condition that the parameter has to be greater than 0. Now, if we debug this code, as such, until your parameter reaches 0, frames are accumulated on the call stack. From then on, you can see frames starting to leave one by one like this. If the given number was too large, an error like the one we experienced might occur during the process of stacking frames. Therefore, when using recursive functions, you must ensure that there's a termination condition and the number of repetitions isn't too high to avoid stack overflow. When you need to perform a task infinitely or repeat it many times, you can use loops like the for loop. Some programming languages provide a feature that allows you to use certain types of recursive functions without constraints, which I'll cover in a separate video later. The call stack is also useful for finding the point of error when debugging. In example 4, functions F1, F2, F3, and F4 call the next function in turn, and an error occurs like this in function F4. Looking at this in the console tab, you can find out in what order various functions are called and where an error occurred. This is what we call a stack trace, which shows the point where an error occurred through a call stack. In practice, where multiple functions are intricately intertwined, this would be very useful in uncovering the cause of a problem. In programming languages, errors generally propagate from top to bottom in the call stack. If an error occurs in the F4 function, that error is passed to the F3 function, and if it is not handled in the F3 function, it is passed to the F2 function. This is called error bubbling. If you look at the code in example 5, you will see that an error occurs in the F4 function as well, and there is code in the F1 and F2 functions to handle errors using the try statement. In a situation where error handling functions are at the very bottom of the stack, the error is propagated downwards, so it first encounters the F2 function. Therefore, the error is handled in the catch section of the F2 function. By understanding the call stack in this manner, you will be able to properly understand many events that occur during program execution. We have looked at the concept of the call stack and a number of simple facts related to it. Based on what you learned in this video, you should be able to understand more concepts. I'll see you again in the next video.